Hello, everybody. Welcome to my talk regarding multi-channel and IO Euring status update within Samba. My name is Stefan Metzmacher. I'm with the Samba team working for Zenit, developing Samba on behalf of our customers. So the topics for today are a very short introduction to what is SMB3 multi-channel, the updates which are available with just released Samba 4.15. What is IO Euring? How is IO Euring used in Samba? And some details about performance research I did and prototyping of ideas in order to get better performance. And at the end, I would like to get some feedback. So, what is SMB3 multi-channel? Basically, with SMB3 and SMB1 also, you are based on a stream connection, typically a TCP connection, and only a single one. And with multi-channel, you can have multiple transport connections in order to get better performance and more reliability and availability. This is not limited to just TCP transports. It's also possible to have RDMA transports like InfiniBand, Rookie, IWARP. And in future, we would also get a quick support, which is also available as transport for SMB. So, all transport connections are bound together basically on the client GUID. That's a random value a client sends in the initial connect to the server, and then it reuses the value in order to get the same connections together. And this is important for Samba because that way we can shift connections to the already existing SMBD process, which handles the connection already. In order to make this more secure, the transports are also connected together using some authentication binding with the session ID, tree ID, and file ID values. And only if you sign the new session connect with the previous session key of the other transport, then you will be able to use shared resources between the connections. So, in order to get the available network interfaces, there's an FSCTL query network interface info command, which just returns the available IP addresses v4 or v6. The interface index in order to let the client distinguish which interface, which IP belongs to which interface, and is basically the same hardware. The link speed of the interface is returned, and the capabilities if the interface is RSS, receive side scaling capable, or RDMA capable. I basically gave similar talks in last year's Storage Developer Conference in 2020, and also an update to that in the Samba XP conference earlier this year. And in this talk, I will skip most of the details I explained there already. So if you're interested in the milestones of older Samba versions up to now, then please have a look at this talk also. So the updates we get with Samba 4.15. So the major blockers were the absence of regression test, and now we have modified socket wrapper in order to support basic file descriptor parsing. And that means we were able to test things automatically in our CI runs. And in order to avoid regressions, we added a lot more regression tests in order to keep the feature regression free. Now, the last missing features and bugs were also fixed. Basically, we had problems with some races between the second connection comes in and the first connection went away. And there was a race where the client could be disconnected, and instead of being served by the original process that handled also the first connection. And we had a problem with the cancellation of pending async operations and with the layout of having multiple transport connections for a client. We should not cancel these operations, but instead make sure that replays are guarded between the channels instead. And typically the client assumes that operations are finished completely, even if they don't get the response and do a replay, but we will catch that and don't redo the operation if it's already done. So with 4.15, we finally changed the default for the server multi-channel support option to yes, but we also only did that for Linux and FreeBSD because these are the only platforms which support querying a socket same queue about the non-ACT bytes in the send queue. And this is important in order to provide reliable retries of oblock and lease break notifications. There's still an option to force multi-channel to be available on other platforms, but we can't advise that, and that shouldn't be the default. So, what is IOU ring? This is an asynchronous infrastructure in order to do IOs. It was introduced with Linux 5.1. And at the start, it was just designed to have a few operations available. And it tries to avoid syscalls as much as possible. So the kernel and the user space share memory mapped rings with a submission queue, SQ, and a completion queue. Both are implemented as ring buffers. And that makes it possible that there are no locking conflicts and the operations are possible to be very fast and efficient. There are also some more verbose descriptions on lwn.net and so on if you're interested in more details here. The key part is that it could be nicely integrated with our async T event model. And it's possible to delegate work to kernel threads in order to have user space threads do some operations which are blocking. It can also do inline non-blocking operations, but most times in our environment, it seems to be better to defer things to async threads instead of doing inline things. But that may depend on the platform and on the workload. So I will get into a few more details about that later. So are you using use in Samba? It's possible to do some basic operations like read V, write V, and fsync. These are just operations to implement basic syscall equivalents to these operations. So it supports buffered and direct I/O, and there are a few operations added a bit later in the 5.8 kernel, which are send message, receive message, and improved versions of that, which support message wait all, which is were added in 5.12 and backported back to 5.10 releases. There is a splice call and a tcall, also basically the same as the raw syscalls for them. And we may use some advanced flags like sqpol or forcing async operations. In the meantime, there were also some path-based operations added to IOURing. They started in the kernel 5.6. This open at 2, statics, unlink at, rename at, make dir at, symlink at, and link at. They were not all included in the initial release, but more gets added in time. And the most important thing is that there is an IOURing register personality. This is basically the glue in order to impersonate other users from within Samba. So this basically snapshots the current credentials of the process and puts that under an ID. And these credentials are then later used for the IOURing calls. With the 5.12 kernel, there's a very important update or feature added to the kernel. This is named native workers. And the thing is that now the helper threads in the kernel are now cloned from the user space thread in a similar way, like a user space thread, but it's done hidden inside the kernel. But the threads are still shown as user space threads. So that means that top will show them as part of the original user space process. So they just appear like a thread blocked in a syscall and never return. That means that the accounting in the kernel is much saner, so you will see exactly which numbers of memory or CPU usage are dedicated to the running process. And it makes it also possible to remove some restrictions which were in the kernel before, because before the kernel threads were shared between processes. So for admins and user space developers, there are no longer the RUWQE work kernel threads. Yes, said before, top shows them as part of the user space process. So that means if there's a user space process, they call it SMBD, and it uses IU ring, then it's typically, or it could be using more than 100% CPU, which means there are also some threads. And if you press uppercase H, top will also show the threads. And it also means that these threads are now visible within containers. So before the old kernel threads, they were only seen by the host system and not by containers. And also ps3-a-t-p is very useful to have a look at them. And they are now shown as iuu-wfrk- and then the PID of the initial thread. So with Samba 4.12, which is basically three releases back, just released 4.15, so about 18 months ago, we introduced a very simple IU ring based VFS module that was only capable of doing pread, pwrite, and fsync. And it just avoided our own thread pool user space implementation and delegated the work to the kernel threads. And with that, I was able to get from 2.2 gigabytes per second to 2.7 gigabytes per second. Maybe the absolute numbers are meaningless here, but the relative numbers are quite good, and there's an improvement which could be seen here. So, but the improvement only happens by avoiding context switches, and the raw data copy still happens twice from or to user space and to or from the file system page cache, which means the most heavy workload is still there, and the data path between user space and socket is completely unchanged. It's just the mechanics which are a bit different, avoiding context switch overhead. So for both cases, the CPU is mostly busy with memcopy. Last October, I was able to do some performance research with a real-world host having a 100 gigabit interface and two NUMA nodes per server. And there I had a client and a server to play with. And at that time, I focused mainly on the SMB2 read performance only, because we had very limited time on the given hardware, and we mainly tested with the fio.exe on the Windows client. and with the Linux 5.8.12 kernel on the server. If you're interested in more details on that, have a look at the link I posted here of the mailing list thread. But I will also go into a few details in the next slide about that. So first I started to analyze the performance of an unchanged SMBD when a Windows client using the FIO XE tried to read as fast as possible from the Samba server. And the results were very disappointing, I would say. With a 100 gigabit network adapter, we were only getting about 20 megabits per second or something like that. So basically 3.8 gigabytes per second with four multi-channel connections. And on the server side, we used more than 500% CPU. So we utilized about five CPU cores completely without giving good performance here. Once again, and the key point was that the send message call, which was synchronous in SMBD, took up to half a millisecond in order to flush our data. And within that time, we were not processing any new I/O. And that was basically the problem. Then I prototyped the usage of IUUring based send message, and that improved the situation quite a bit. So basically with four connections, we get up to 6.8 gigabytes per second, and SMBD only uses 11% of our CPU, while for IUUring kernel threads were using about 50% of the CPU. So basically we're still above 300% CPU, but it's better performance and less CPU usage than with the raw send message core. So what we also noticed was that this is quite NUMA affected in the performance. So based on the NUMA bouncing, we had between 5 gigabytes and 7.6 gigabytes, which were just randomly happen without anything we were able to do here. And one key point is also that the memcopy, the copy user enhanced fastlink function in the Linux kernel, were basically still the major bottleneck here. With that, we try to utilize the IUUring based splice call in order to write the mem copies. And with that, and also with bumping up the number of connections the Windows client were doing, because we found that the Windows client was actually the bottleneck in all these tests at that point, we bumped it up to 16 connections. And with that, we were able to see 8.9 gigabytes per second from the Windows client, where the main SMBD when just using 5% of the CPU and a lot of IO Turing threads using 3 to 12% CPU. So in total, we were at about 100% of CPU. So basically, we were just utilizing one CPU core anymore while getting way better performance and actually maxed out the performance which was available from the Windows client, which were kept at 75 gigabits per second, which were mapped to 8.9 gigabytes per second. So in order to get more high numbers, we experimented with using SMB client as a client instead of using the Windows client, and with that we were able to get even better performance. So with four connections, I basically started SMB client four times with a little hack to use the same client GUID on all of them in order to get to the same server process from all of the three, all of the four connections. So with that, we get 11 gigabytes per second, where SMBD is at 8.6% CPU, and four worker threads at 20% CPU each. And it's basically the same performance we also got with IPERF between two servers here. And in the PERF output on the left, you will see that do TCP send pages is now the bottleneck at just 7%, while we had the MemCompy equivalent at 60% before. And you also see in the middle the top output that SMB client is basically the bottleneck here with consuming about 100 percent of the CPU. So in order to get much more better numbers, I switched to using loopback without network interfaces in between, and there I used eight connections, which gave me about 22 gigabytes per second, where the SMBD uses 22% CPU and four kernel threads also about 22% each. And still, the SMB client is a bottleneck here. And we still get back the copy user enhanced fast ring, which is the memcopy equivalent. But this time, this is caused by the SMB client processes, which are still the bottleneck here. So recently, or a few months ago, but also recently again, I tested with more modern hardware and redid the loopback retest using send message and splice, and in order to be independent of file system and disk, I used DevSRHM, and there with one connection I was able to get between 10 and 13 gigabytes per second, where SMBD is just at 7% CPU with four worker threads at between 7 and 50% CPU. So that's basically similar to what I got with 4 SMB client binaries between the other hosts before. Then I switched to 4 connections on that host, and there I got numbers between 24 and 30 gigabytes per second. All these numbers are quite randomly, and I don't understand how this happens. So one day I get constantly, say, 13 gigabytes per second. The next day I only get 10, and I didn't find any obvious reason for that yet. But at least compared with the original numbers without IOUing, we have a lot of improvements here. So on that host, without IOUing on all this stuff, I'm getting about 3 gigabytes per second for a single connection. Now, I also implemented SMB2 writes with IOUing receive message and splice. And then here also, in order to be independent of file system and disk write performance, I tested with DefNarr, and there I was able to get 7 to 8 gigabytes per second for a single connection, and about 10 gigabytes per second for with 4 connections. And the load of the SMBD and the worker threads are relatively low compared to what we had before. So this time I tested with a 5.13 kernel, which had the native worker feature of IOUing already. And in both cases, the bottleneck is still the SMB client side. And when I get time, I may be able to change that to also use the IOUing based IO instead of send message and receive message, and also with splice. So there's potential to optimize the client side, and then I guess we would also get higher numbers because we removed the bottleneck, which is the client here. And in all testing, it seemed also that the code path between, or the data flow between file system, the splice pipe, and the socket is much better optimized than the other way around, from the socket to the splice pipe back to the file system. So improvements with the just released 4.15 release of Samba. There we get support for AES 128 GMAC signing. This was also recently added to Windows versions, and it's based on the already used AES 4.128 GCM, which is used for encryption, but in this case we only provide the authenticated clear text data and avoid the encryption part of it. And with that, the GNUTLS library, which we depend on, provided about 6 gigabytes per second for the GCM version with encryption, and about 10 gigabytes per second for the GMAC signing. And with that, we are able to get relatively good numbers even with signing enabled. So in order to make use of the iodine and splice optimizations. I try to do some tricks here. So I use the splice from the file into the splice pipe and then use the T operation in order to mirror the content of the splice pipe into a second T pipe. And from there, I use the read operation from the T pipe into user space buffer. We may also use the M splice syscall. Maybe that gets even better performance, but I hadn't enough time to experiment with that yet. But that means that the original data from the file is still available in the splice pipe, and the user space buffer is only used to calculate the signing signature. And then the SMBD logic switches back to the splice pipe and uses send message and splice in order to deliver the data back to the client and avoids copying data back from user space to the kernel. And with that, I was able to get about 5 gigabytes per second with signing enabled, where we had just 3 gigabytes before. So, some future improvements which I experimented with is when using receive message and splice, the thing is that partial SMB packets are delivered to user space. And with 8 megabyte IOs or logic IOs from the client side, we get a lot of wake-ups, even if the complete message is not available yet. And it causes quite some overhead with context switches and so on. And there I experimented with the AFKCM, the kernel multiplexer module, and the eBPF helper. But that wasn't able to get better performance. It even got worse with it. But then I found that we could use the message wait all flag to receive message. And with that, we had a much simpler solution and which was also much faster and reduce the CPU load quite a bit here. I also prototyped a splice wait all flag. That also helped a bit, but I need to sit down and write real implementation and tests in order to propose it for the upstream corner. And there's also the eBPF support for IOUing on the horizon. I guess it's currently discussed at some Linux conference, and I'm not sure what the name is, Plumbers or something like that. So maybe in the remaining of the year we will get support for eBPF into IOUing, where we would be able to dynamically supply a short BPF program which can run in the kernel and orchestrate the operations we need to Yeah, it's that before it seems that the socket pipe to file system code path or data flow doesn't completely implement a zero copy for all cases. And then we could also optimize that one. And in the end, I still have my SMB Direct RDMA module for the kernel available. This is still a work in progress, but the basics are there, and I just need to glue it together with the iodurine based improvements I had here. And also with the native workers feature, we basically have all infrastructure there in order to implement this and get even, or hopefully even lower CPU overhead. So that's it from my side. If you have real world hardware and can do some real world tests here, I would appreciate your feedback here. Otherwise, thank you for your attention. Goodbye.